Somebody stand up and share your favorite verse with us. No favorite verses?
1 Peter 5:7.
Amen. Somebody else? Anybody else?
In all our ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths.
Amen. Anybody else?
3:6. 1 John 5:13 says, these things have I written unto you, to believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that they have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God.
Amen. Anybody else?
Thanks be called Wonderful Counselor, of Mighty God, the Everlasting Father.
Amen. 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 Sister Melinda?
Jeremiah 33:12,
saying,
I will
show thee
great
mighty
things
which thou knowest
not.
Amen. Somebody else? Hunter?
Ephesians 13:5, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee.
Amen. Well, Jerry? Amen. Amen. Loretta?
Romans 8:1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but
after
the Spirit.
Amen. Brother John?
Psalm 119:11, I order my head in my heart.
Amen. Anybody else? Brother Jerry? Sharon?
Philippians 4:19. My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Jesus Christ.
Amen. Matt?
Matthew 19:26. But Jesus beheld them and said unto them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible.
Amen. Twilight? Amen. Elaine?
Ephesians 6:10-11. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil.
Amen. Anybody else? Julie?
Isaiah 42:2. When thou passest through the waters, I'll be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee.
Amen. Whitty? Okay. Anybody else? What's Sam?
I have two as well. Joshua 24:15-16. If this be one of you to serve the Lord, choose you this day that you will serve. Whether the gods which your fathers served that were on this other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And the people answered and said, God forbid that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods.
Amen. Anybody else? Levi?
12:13. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me.
Amen. Don't leave anybody out. And one of the things that so precious is the Word of God. We're in a series in Psalms 119, and it's dealing with the Word of God, about putting it in our hearts, about letting it direct our lives. And there should be scripture in our hearts and minds continually. Somebody, I think it maybe was Brother John, quoted Psalms 119:11, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against God. And the fact is that's so important. And here we are on Wednesday night, and I would love just to rip loose on one and just have a shout and message. But you know, sometimes we got to learn, and we got to get some things in our hearts. And one of the things we got to get in our hearts is the Word of God. It's important. To grow in the Lord, we've got to take the Word of God and we've got to put it in our lives. put in our hearts and minds. Take your Bibles and turn to Psalm 119. Psalm 119. And all of the book of Psalm, or the whole chapter of Psalm 119, all the way through, as we've mentioned, deals with the Word of God in some form or fashion. Many times we read straight through it and we never really stop and consider what is taking place. Now understand, this is David that is writing this psalm. And this psalm that he's writing here is dealing with the Word of God. David's been through an awful lot and seen an awful lot. And so he's looking at the different things and he's bringing everything back to the Word of God and the importance of the Word of God in his life. And he's leaving us a foundation for us to look at to build our lives on around the Word of God. Many times we don't build our lives around the Word of God. We try to take a piece of the Word of God and shove it into our lives when we need it. And really what needs to be done is that our lives are built upon and around the things that's in the Word of God. You don't build the Word of God upon your life. You build your life upon the Word of God. And so many times we fail to do that. We try to make the Word of God fit us instead of us fitting the Word of God. And that is not the way God planned it. If you would please stand for the reading of God's Word. We're going to begin in verse 25. It says, "My soul cleaveth unto the dust." Man, I tell you what, you start off right there. It's like, man, David is down. He's in the dust. He said, "My soul cleaveth." He's hugging the ground. He's at the bottom. He said, "My soul cleaveth the dust." He said, "Quicken thou me according to thy word. I have declared my ways, and thou heardest me. Teach me thy statutes. Make me to understand the way of thy precepts. So shall I talk of thy wondrous works. My soul melteth for heaviness. Strengthen thou me according unto thy word. Remove from me the way of lying, and grant me thy law graciously. I have chosen the way of truth. Thy judgments have I laid before me. I have stuck unto thy testimonies. O Lord, put me not to shame. I will run the way of thy commandments when thou shalt enlarge my heart." If you look again at verse 25, it says, "My soul cleaveth unto the dust. Quicken thou me according to thy word." I'd like to preach to you, burned out, burdened down, and built up. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to open the Word of God, to share it with one another tonight as others have quoted Scripture or read Scripture. And Lord, it is precious and it should be in our hearts. It should be on our minds. It should direct our lives. And so, Lord, I pray that as we look at the Scripture tonight and we really are talking about the Scripture and the effect that it has in our lives and how it should be applied to our lives, Lord, I pray that you would challenge us to make it a part of our daily bread. And so, Lord, I pray now, bless each heart that's here, strengthen, you know, the needs of every person. These things we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated. If you've ever watched a boxing match, if you've watched very many of them, you will at some point see maybe a boxer that may be a better boxer than the other. He begins to wear down his contender. He begins to get him wore down and he's beginning to weaken, and all of a sudden he'll reach down inside of himself and he'll begin a barrage of blows and hit that his opponent, knocking him to the mat. And many times when that opponent hits that mat, they back him off and the referee comes over and he begins to stand over him and he begins to count. And during that period of time, that boxer that's laying on that mat many times is struggling himself to get back up. Within him and everything within his fiber, he doesn't want to quit. He wants to continue. He wants to fight. He wants to do everything he can to win the match and be the one that conquered the better fighter. And so he's everything within him, he's fighting with inside himself to get his body to get back up. And many times, he's unable to get back up off the mat. With everything in his mind going on, he knows that he's down. With every count that he hears that referee, 6, 7, 8, and he hears him counting, and he knows if he reaches 10 that it's too late. And everything inside him, every fiber in his body is saying, get up, get up, you've got to get up. And everything within him is trying to get up, but he can't move. He's down for the count. And what's sad is that there's a lot of Christians that land in that same position. To be honest with you, there's times that everyone in this room, you're going to land in that position. You're going to be down. You're going to be in a position where you want to get up in your mind and your heart. You want to go on for the Lord. You want to serve God. You're wanting to do everything that you can for God, but you just can't get up. So we see David here as he's looking, and as we begin in verse 25, and it's one of those things, it's sometimes in our spiritual lives we find ourselves in that situation. You're facing that adversary. And by the way, that adversary is the devil and the world and the flesh. And to be honest with you, Satan has taken out a lot stronger people than you and me. And so we know that we're against a very strong contender. In Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12 it says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." If we could have a physical fight, we feel like we could have a chance. But you've got to realize here tonight, and you've got to get a hold of this, you've got to understand this. The battle that you're in, the battle that I'm in, is a spiritual battle. It's not fought with our fist. It's not fought with knives and guns. It's fought in a spiritual arena. And the battle goes on, and we're fighting that spiritual battle, and Satan knows your weaknesses. Many times in a boxing match, before the match ever starts, they'll study their opponent and they will watch and they'll say, hey, did you see him flinch when he hit him in this spot? And we go back to another match and say, hey, did you see him flinch real bad when they hit him in that same spot? And basically what they're looking for in that fighter is a weak spot. Because they realize if they can work that weak spot over in that fighter's life or in that fighter's body, that they're able to take him down. It may be in a spot in his abdomen. It may be a certain blow to the jaw. It may be wherever it's at. And they're looking for a weakness in the fighter that they fight against. Can I tell you something? Satan is not looking for your weakness. He already knows what it is. He already knows what it is. You say, preacher, how does he know what it is? He's done seen it. And so he's going to work on your weakness. He's going to work on an area of your life to bring you to the mat, to bring you down. Many times we don't stop and realize, and we beat our own selves up a lot of times. And really what's taking place is a spiritual battle. Satan is sitting back laughing because he's pounding you in a spot that he knows is your weakness. And he's got you against the floor and he's got you down on the mat, and you want to get up. You try to get up and maybe you can't. David knows how that feels. Look again at these two verses here, verse 25 and verse 28. He says, "My soul cleaveth unto the dust." David is talking about a specific time, and I don't know what time it is, or maybe more than one specific time in his life, when he was so down that he says, "My soul cleaveth the dust." He said, you can't get any lower than that. In verse 28, he says, "My soul melteth for heaviness." He said, I've just melted away. I was... I don't know, I've seen it somewhere. I've seen some pictures and somebody was showing. I don't know if it was on Facebook or what. And I just thought they were, he said, "My soul melteth away." Somebody had, and there's two or three people put pictures of it. Back in the summer when it was really hot, some kids had left some crayons in the car, laying on the seat. And there was just this mingle of color running across the seat. Those crayons had melted. And to be honest, sometimes that's the way we are in our soul. The things of this life just melt us down. And we're not able to hold together. You say, well, preacher, it sounds like that there's no use, that we might as well give up. No, that's not what we're talking about tonight. David's the one speaking of this, and he's trying to get us to see something. And here's David, a man that's after God's own heart, and David is looking at his own life. He says, this is a problem that I've got. This is where I'm struggling. In our description of it, David is describing someone who we might today call burnt out or burdened down, carrying a heavy load. Sometimes that affects every Christian in their spiritual life at times, and so we need to know how to handle it, because you're going to face it, and what we've got to do is we've got to be able to face the situation and come out of it for the honor and glory of God. In reality, God uses these times, listen to me, God uses these times in your life and my life to build us up and to strengthen us. It sounds like it's used to beat us down. No, it's used to strengthen you up and to build you up if you allow it to. First of all, let's look at the burned out part. Every time you make a genuine decision in your life, you decide, I'm going to serve God, I'm going to live for Him, I'm going to put Him first. Maybe I'm going to be a better soul winner, I'm going to read my Bible, I'm going to pray more, I'm going to tell people about Jesus Christ, I'm going to pass out more gospel tracts, I'm going to get more involved in church, I'm going to do this. Every time that you make a genuine effort, notice I said genuine, a genuine effort to serve God and get closer to Him, get ready. Because there's going to be three things that's going to attack you. Number one, your flesh is going to attack you. You ever said, you know, I'm going to get up earlier and read my Bible more and pray? And your flesh fights you. The second thing that's going to fight you is the world. If you make a genuine effort to serve God in a greater way, the world's going to fight you. And thirdly, Satan's going to fight you. See, Satan walketh about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. He's looking for the opportunity. And when he sees that you are in an effort to serve God, to get closer to God, to become stronger in the Lord, he's going to attack in a greater way, because he doesn't want you to grow. He doesn't want you off of the mat. He wants you to be beat down. And so he's going to begin to try to attack you and try to bring you down. He'll use the world. He'll use your own flesh, whatever he has to. He'll do that. David was cleaving to the dust here. Notice again, he says, my soul cleaveth unto the dust. He said, I'm as low as I possibly can get. You begin to think about cleaving to the dust. It would be going out here on a gravel road and laying down on that dusty road just as low as you can get and eating the dust. David said, I'm as low as I can get. David's down for the count. He needs to get up, and he doesn't have the strength within himself. He said, I don't have that strength. We might say David needs revival. If we was talking about, we talk a lot about revival, needing revival, and I need revival in my life. The church needs revival. Our nation needs revival. And so we might say that David needs revival because he's down and he's discouraged and he's burnt out and he's being attacked. And so he needs revival. You know, everyone in this room, and I think it's Brother Jimmy that quoted the verse from Isaiah 41 there about mounting up on wings as eagles and walking and running and doing all those things and not fainting. We would all be that way. We would all desire that. I think every Christian says, man, that's the type of Christian life I want. I don't want to be down. I don't want to be discouraged. I don't want to be burned out. I want to be soaring like an eagle. But the fact is, our old sin nature pulls us down. The things of this world pulls us down. The battles that we face, they pull us down. It becomes very real, the words of Paul in Romans chapter 7. Romans chapter 7, Paul puts it this way in verse 15 and 16, and also down in verse 19. He says, For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that I do not. But what I hate, that I do. He goes on, verse 16, he says, if then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Verse 19, he says, for the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do. And you see the Apostle Paul, probably one of the strongest Christians that walked the face of the earth, that wrote most of our New Testament, is a man that's saying, you know what, I struggle with my flesh and I struggle with the world and I struggle with Satan. And there's times when I get down and there's times that I realize that I need to be doing this and I don't do it. And there's times that I realize that I'm not supposed to be doing this and I do it. Have you been there? All of us have. David's in the same position, and he says that he cleaveth to the dust. He said, my soul cleaveth to the dust. He needs revival. He needs to be picked up. David calls for that reviving there. And notice there that he calls for that reviving. He says, quicken thou me according to thy word. Quicken. Quicken. When you and I were created here, we were born from our mothers. But when Adam, the first man, was created, he was created out of what? The dust of the earth. God formed him out of the dust of the earth. And the Bible says that God breathed into his nostrils and made him what? A living soul. That is exactly what the term in the word quicken means, is to be breathed upon and made a living soul. And so what David is saying, he's saying, quicken me, breathe upon me, and bring life back into me. Revive me. Revive my spiritual man. He said, I need that spiritual man revived. I need that spiritual man brought back where it's excited. You know, hey, listen, every one of us, if we're not careful, we come into church, we sit down and you know, oh, man, you know, had a rough day, you know, and man, you know, I don't feel good, and I'll tell you what, things are going on. I ain't got enough money to pay my bills, and we're just getting down, and we're discouraged. I didn't like what the preacher preached the other day, and I didn't make sense to me, and I don't know why. Everybody else gets, I don't know what's a big deal, and we get down, and we get discouraged. Man, it ain't going good at work, and everybody's against me, and I don't even feel like going to church, and I don't even feel like reading my Bible. I don't even want to pray. And what you're needing is revived. You're needing to be quickened. You're needing that life brought back into you spiritually to get you excited. Have you, you know, there's been times that you get the flu or you get something and you just want to go in bed. You just want to pull the covers up over your head. You want everybody to leave you alone. You want them to stay away from you. Just leave me alone. And Lord, if you could, rapture would be great before I throw up the next time. And you're like, this is it. And then all of a sudden, you know, after a period of time, you get rid of the flu and you start, and you're able to eat again and you get your energy back. And boy, man, I feel so much better. And you're revived. You feel better. It's like those times, and I don't mean to be gross, but you get sick at your stomach and you feel like you're going to throw up and you're thinking, I'm dying. And finally, you're able to regurgitate. I'm from Southeast Missouri. You're able to throw up. And after you're done, it's like, oh, I feel so much better. You've been revived. Not a real good way to revive, but I mean, that's what you did. You revived, you survived. David's saying, listen, I'm down. I'm in the dust. I'm as low as I can get. He says, Lord, would you revive me? Would you quicken me? Would you bring life back into me spiritually? He's not talking about his physical body. He's talking about his spiritual being. He says, quicken me. Bring life back in. And I'm going to be honest with you. I look at a lot of churches and I look at a lot of church members and different ones, and I say, Lord, they need to be quickened. They need to come alive. They need a reviving. They need a stirring in their hearts again. I'm looking around the room tonight and I'm thinking some tonight. You need a reviving. You need a quickening. I mean, I can't even get a smile out of some of you. And the fact is that, hey, listen, he begins to call on the Lord. He wanted the Lord to quicken him. And David's saying, revive me, give me life again, bring me spiritually alive. And then David begins to claim. Notice what he does. He claims the word of God in the same verse there. He says, quicken thou me. Well, how? According to thy word. Remember, we talked about how that the word of God is so important to us. David said, I'm as low as I can get. I need to be revived. And Lord, would you use the word of God and do it? When I worked on the ambulance, we carried oxygen in the ambulance. And there was different times that we would go and pick someone up. And a lot of times when we popped out of the ambulance, and first guy would go over and do triage, begin to look at it, say what we got here, see what the breathing was, see what the pulse was, and see what their heart rate was, and there's times that maybe the breathing was so shallow that we'd say grab some oxygen, and they would go and get the oxygen, we'd put the oxygen on, and it's amazing how many times they would begin to revive. They begin to breathe that pure oxygen. And they begin to get a breath of fresh air. And what some of us need today is a breath of fresh air. We need to be revived by the Spirit of God as He breathes into us and breathes that new life into us. He says, listen, I need to be revived. Lord, would you use the Word of God? Would you revive me with the Word? Would you quicken me? Would you put that back in my heart again? Would you stir my heart with it? It's the Spirit of God reviving our spirit by the Word of God, using it. It's not the and by the way, it's not the act of just picking up the Bible and reading that's going to do it. But it is the understanding of what? With the heart, the attitude of the heart as we read the Word of God that makes the difference. It's not, as I said, the reading, but it's the attitude in which you read it. Many of us sit down and read our Bibles because we know we're supposed to read our Bibles and have our daily devotion. But you know what we do? We have the wrong attitude when we read it. We're reading it so that we can check off on our little paper. I read this. Got through the Bible this year. And yet we missed out what God had for us all year long. It was our attitude. When's the last time? And you may have to slow down and not go through the Bible in a whole year. But whatever that you need to do, and begin to look and begin to take it and look for understanding. Receiving the Word of God into your heart and obeying the Word of God. Submitting yourself to the Word of God. Here's our problem. A lot of times we know what it says, but we won't do what it says. We know what the Bible is already trying to tell us, but we don't want to submit to it. And so what we need is we need to have the right attitude towards the Word of God. We need that reviving in our lives. It's that renewing of the Spirit of God within our lives from the Word of God. And that's so important. David is then moved to confessing some things in his life. Look at verse 26. It says, I have declared my ways, and thou heardest me. Teach me thy statutes. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He's talking about confessing our sins. David here in verse 26 here, he's talking about confessing. He said, I have declared my ways. I'm telling you, Lord, what I did. That's what he's saying. He said, I'm confessing my sin. I know I've sinned against you, Lord, and so I'm confessing it. He says, and thou heardest me. And so what he's doing, he's asking for forgiveness. No one likes to admit that you're wrong. If I went around the room and begin to say, hey, do you like to be found that you was wrong about something? Everybody in this room, nobody likes to be found out that they're wrong. And we'll even argue about it. We'll even fuss about it. My wife sometimes, she thinks I'm wrong, but I'm not. I don't remember it that way. We don't like to be wrong, do we? Sometimes when I'm preaching and I'll give illustrations about our lives, something happened years ago or maybe last week, I don't know, but and we get home, she said, that's not the way it was. I said, yes, it was. No, that's not the way it was. And I said, that's the way I remember it. She said, well, you remember it wrong then. And I don't want to admit that I was wrong. Later on, I get to think about, you know, well, she's probably right, but I'm not going to tell her. Because we don't want to admit that we're wrong. But can I tell you something? The only way you can get out of the dust, the only way that you can get that reviving fresh breath, is it starts with confessing. It starts with admitting that we're wrong. Starts with admitting, God, forgive me. I need cleansing. So David, he begins to ask for that forgiveness there. If we're going to get out of that burnout section in our lives, we've got to confess it. David goes on and he desires knowledge and understanding. Look at verse 27. He says, Make me to understand the way of thy precepts, so shall I talk of thy wondrous works. He said, Lord, I don't just want to know about it. He said, I want to understand it. Many times people have a lot of knowledge. And with that knowledge, they can't even get out of the rain. I remember a fella, he was a teacher in our high school when I was in high school. And I didn't have him for a class, but I heard a lot of things about him. He graduated from college and I mean, honors and everything in college. This guy was sharp. I mean, he had knowledge. But he didn't have enough understanding to get out of the rain. No common sense. He's the type of guys that you would tell, hey, listen, you need to change your blinker fluid on your car. You need to rotate the air in your tires. And he'd go out and try to do it. He'd try to find it in a book first, but he'd go out and try to do it. Very knowledgeable, but no understanding. And one of the problems he could not teach what he knew because he didn't understand what he knew. The Lord says it's more than just knowledge. He said, you need some understanding. You need to understand what God's telling you. And part of that comes through experiencing what God's trying to do in your life. You go through a difficult time and God gives you some scripture and you see that and then you begin to understand what He's talking about. You begin to learn to trust Him. You know, somebody, Brother Jim, quoted Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6 here. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding in all the ways. Acknowledge Him and He shall direct thy paths. Be not wise in thine own eyes, but fear the Lord and depart from evil. He didn't quote all that, but it's part of that in there. But you know, that only comes the understanding. You can quote that all day long, and it doesn't do you any good until you experience, put it into action. That's when you understand it. Amen. When you have to accept it. When you have to apply it to your life. That's when the understanding comes. And so David's saying, hey, he said, Lord, please. He said, let me have understanding here. He said, I need understanding. And so as you get into the Word of God, and again, we're talking about the Word of God. And so David's saying, Lord, would you help me to understand? He said, make me to understand the way of thy precepts, the way of the Bible, the way of the Word of God. It's more than just mere knowledge. It's also that understanding. When you're down in the dust and you're burned out and it's hard to be a witness to others, isn't it? It's hard to talk about the Lord when you're down. It's hard to encourage others in the Lord when you're down. It's hard to share what Jesus Christ has done in your heart and life when you're down in the dust. And so David says, Lord, he says, make me to understand thy way so that shall I talk of thy wondrous works. You know why it's so important for you not to stay in the dust? Because people are watching your life and you need to be a witness and you need to be a testimony of what God can do in your life every single day. Even if you have problems, even if you have difficulties, even if you have struggles. Hey, listen, you need to be a good witness for God. But unless you understand the Word of God, unless you repent of your sin and ask the Lord to forgive you, you'll not get revived, and you'll be in the dirt, and you'll not be a witness for Jesus Christ. And Satan will laugh his head off at you because you say you're a child of the King. Woe is me. You're a child of the King? Where's your daddy? Boy, your daddy's not taking very good care of you. It's one thing, every one of us are going to wind up on the mat, but there's no reason staying there. We can be revived. We can have that energy to serve God again. And so he's asking for that knowledge so that he can have understanding. Then look at burden down. I want us to look at burden down. That was burn out, but burden down is a little bit different. Burn out would come from trying to do things in the power of your own flesh and the constant attacks of the world and the flesh and the devil. But being burdened down is a little bit different. Burdened down would be carrying, stumbling and staggering under the load of life and the ministry and things that you're in or the things that you're trying to do that's right. Hey, listen, every person in this room, there's times in your life that you get such a heavy load that it brings you down. It may be that you have a wayward child. It brings you down. It may be that you have problems with your finances. It brings you down. It may be that you're having trouble at work and struggles there, and you don't even know if the job's going to be there tomorrow. It brings you down. It may be things are happening within the family or the relationship, and it brings you down. And it's a heavy load, and you get burdened down. It may be your health, and it burdens you down. It may be the health of a loved one. And the worry of it and everything brings you down, and there's a load, and it's a legitimate load many times. And it drags you down spiritually. So many times as Christians we get drugged down by the things around us, by people around us. And it really becomes a burden to us. And so it gets us down. And look at verse 20, it says, "My soul melteth." Notice how? For heaviness. My soul melteth for heaviness. The load that he's carrying. David says, part of my problem as the king, he said, I'm carrying such a load. He said, it brings me down. It loads me down. He said, I'm carrying this heavy load and it pulls me down. Many times that's what's happening in your life and my life is we get drugged down by the heaviness of the things around us. Many Christians just get so burdened down by the difficulties of this life that they then just want to quit. Just want to quit. Have you ever been there? Have you got down? You said, oh, forget it. And you have such a burden that you just want to stop. You just want to quit. And you just want to throw in the towel. And you just want to say, I don't want to do this anymore. I can't handle it anymore. And you just want to quit. Hey, listen, I've counseled with Christian after Christian that's been through that where they just, man, I just got some burden down. I just want to quit. That's what David said. He said, I melted under the load of it. He said, my soul melteth. Again, we need to turn to the Word of God for strength, which will turn us from the lies and the junk of this world and strengthen us. No, sorry, he says, strengthen thou me according unto thy word. How is David going to get out of the situation where his soul is melting for the heaviness, the burden, the load that he's carrying? He says, Lord, strengthen me. When he's talking about strength, he says, help me to bear up underneath it. He's not saying, take it away. Do you know what most of us want to say? Lord, would you take this load off of me? Take the load off of me. Take the load off of me. Let me show you something. Matt, come here. Levi, come here. Jump up on him, piggyback, man. Now, he can carry him that way for a while, but he's going to get tired. Here's what we want to do. Take the load off. But you know what the Lord says? And what David said there? He says, keep the load, but let me give you the strength to carry it. There's a lot of difference. We're wanting God, get the load off of me. Take the load off of me. I can't handle it anymore. And we wonder why God doesn't just supernaturally just reach out and take the load off of us. And we're like, oh. It's because, like David said, he said, no, he said, I want you to grow. He said, I want you to be strong. And so I'm going to leave the load there, but I'm going to strengthen you and help you carry the load. Thank you, fellas. And so we want the load off of us. But David didn't say anything about taking the load off. He said, strengthen me. Give me more strength so I can carry more. Can I tell you something this day and time we're living in? We need Christians who are going to say, we need more strength to carry the load because the load's going to get heavier. The load's going to be bigger than it's ever been before. And we need Christians who are going to be able to be strong enough to handle it and carry it in their families and carry it in their churches and carry it in our nation. We need the strength. We don't necessarily need the burden gone. We just need more strength. We're living. Can I just get real honest with you? We're living in a day and time when most Christians are a bunch of sissies. I don't know how else to put it. They quit. They just throw in the towel. Because it gets a little heavy. When God says you don't have to quit and you don't have to throw in the towel and I don't have to take the load off of you, He said, listen, I'll get under the load with you. What did the Lord say? He said, my load is what? My burden is easy and my load is what? Light. And the Lord will help us to bear up that load under that. Notice in verse 28, He said, my soul melteth, strengthen thou me according to thy word. Verse 29 says, remove me from the way of lying. The way of lying would be the way of the world. The world lies all the time. So He says, remove me from that way. Don't let me follow after that way. Goes on, verse 30 says, I have chosen the way of what? Truth. He said, take me out of the way of the world as far as the lying of it and help me not to fall for their lies and guide me and direct me through the way of truth. He says, how are you going to do that? He says, thy judgments have I laid before me. He said, the word of God, I've laid it before me. In verse 31, He says, I have stuck unto thy testimonies. O Lord, put me not to shame. You know what He said? He said, Lord, hey, listen, I'm going to stay with the book. Doesn't matter what the load gets like. Doesn't matter how low I get. Doesn't matter what the burden's like. He said, I'm going to stay with the Bible. I'm going to stay with God's Word because it's truth. Because it's right. Because it'll breathe life into me. Because it will revive me. Because it will strengthen me. Because it will help me in the times of trouble. When Satan comes to attack, He said, I'm going to make it stick in my heart and life. Do you know what most Christians do today? When the difficulties come, and when the troubles come, and when they get burdened down, when they get burned out, they don't go to the Bible. They go to Dr. Phil. Oprah Winfrey. All the talk shows. All the how-to books instead of going to the Word of God. David said, it's going to stick. It's going to stay. I'm going to stay with it. Then lastly, built up. Look in verse 32. Now I'm closing. He said, I will run the way of thy commandments then when thou shalt enlarge my heart. Now this is a very strange thing. Look at verse 25. He says, what? I'm in the dust. Verse 32, He says, I'm ready to run. I'm ready to run. Isn't that amazing? There were some guys at a church one time, and they would get up every morning real early, and they would meet, and they would work out at the church and everything. And finally, one day, they said, hey, listen, we're going to do this, 30-kilometer march. We're going to see who's the toughest. We're going to do it with a 25, a 40-pound, and a 60-pound backpack. And we're going to see who comes in first. They said, be sure you've got some good boots. And so there were some young guys, some middle-aged guys, and some that was a little bit older, and they decided they was going to do it that morning, and they got there, and the preacher, he didn't have any good boots, and so a military man there had a pair of boots and said, here, you need some good boots. He said, use my boots. He said, that was great because they was broke in. He said they was good boots. The only problem is, he said, there's two sizes too big. He said, well, that's okay because I'm going to wear two pair of socks. So he wore two pair of socks and he got in those boots. And after about 2 miles, he said, my feet began to feel like water. He said, I knew what was happening. He said, it was rubbing blisters on my feet. And he said, I knew I was in trouble. He said, I couldn't let all these young bucks know that I was going to have to drop out after just 2 miles of carrying this. I couldn't give in to all that. What am I going to do? And he said, I thought of this verse where David said that he run. And so he come up on his toes and he began to jog. And he said, it changed where it was rubbing. And he said, I would run about 50 steps, and then I'd walk about 50 steps. He said, I would run about 50 steps, I'd walk about 50 steps. He said, I would pass up some of those young guys, and they would look at me. He said, they was about to drop over in the ditch. And he said, finally, when we got through and got into it, he said, they finally came in. They said, preacher, we want to give up way back here, but we seen you running. He said, it encouraged us. He said, I never told him that's the only way I was going to make it. He said, I had to get off of the other part of my feet. He said, I had to quit walking and start running. Can I tell you something? We need some Christians to say, you know what? I'm so tired. I'm so burdened down. I'm so much in the dust. I'm going to have to run. You say, preacher, that don't make sense. Not with man, but it does with God. It does with God. Oh, how he said, I want to build you up. He said, I want to strengthen you. Galatians 5:16 says, this I say, then walk in the Spirit and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Well, if we walk in the Spirit, hey, listen, we'll be able to run. He said, preacher, what do you mean walk in the Spirit? I'm talking about walking with God. In our daily devotions, in the Word of God, in prayer, and seeking the Lord, and walk with Him. In Galatians 5:25 says, if we live in the Spirit, let's also walk in the Spirit. Hey, listen, you're no longer depending on your strength, but the Lord's as He fills you and builds you up. This verse that Brother Jimmy quoted a while ago, Isaiah 40:31 says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. And notice what it says, they shall mount up with wings as eagles. They were wore out. They were tired. They were down. He said, but when they waited on the Lord, He said they mount up on wings. And notice what He says then. He says, and they shall run. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and not faint. How? Because they took time to draw nigh to God so that God would draw nigh to them. How did that happen, preacher? With the Word of God. With the Word of God. David said it stuck. It stayed right there. He said it stayed within my heart. And he tells us there, he said, when thou shalt enlarge my heart. Can I tell you what happens? Here's how it is. You're down. You're discouraged. You're in the dust. And you begin to look at the Word of God and you begin to let it go into your heart. And the Word of God that goes into your heart begins to enlarge your heart. And it causes you to draw nigh to God. And as you draw nigh to God, your heart enlarges. They say that a person who exercises and runs and on a continual basis, like an athlete, that their heart is generally larger than the average person. Because your heart is a muscle. And when you get to exercise and it begins to pump a little harder, and when you exercise a muscle, what happens to it? It grows. And so they say that their heart is a little bit larger. And so, my friend, when you begin to exercise the Word of God in your heart and in your mind, your heart begins to enlarge. It gets closer to God. And you fall more in love with Him. And the Spirit of God breathes new life into you. And you're able to get up and not just walk. You're able to run. But John, what do you call it when you start running and that first segment is a certain way, and you'll start breathing hard, and after a little bit, something else kicks in. What do we call it? Our second wind. Our second wind. Some of you tonight need to get your second wind and run. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Father, we thank You for loving us. Thank you for the Word of God and what it will do in our hearts and lives. Have your will and way, Lord, in this invitation. Lord, there may be some here who are burnt out. There may be some here who are burdened down. There may be, Lord, those who are struggling. Lord, just help them to trust the Word of God. Be strengthened by your Word. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand. Hunter, what we're going to